And welcome, you're watching Fine Print. I'm Bhairavi Singh, and our special focus tonight on the show is on Afghanistan, and the US-Taliban peace deal will be signed in Doha tomorrow, and both India and Pakistan are going to be part of the final talks. WION continues to get you the ground reports from Doha. Reporters Mustafa Kazmini, Anas Malik and Siddhant Sibyl will be getting you around-the-clock updates on the crucial agreement. Now, the Pakistani Prime Minister Imran Khan is already in Qatar ahead of the deal. This is the second visit to Qatar after he became the Prime Minister in 2018. However, Imran Khan will not be attending the signing ceremony of the landmark deal. Instead, the Foreign Minister Shah Mahmood Qureshi will be representing Pakistan at the event. The peace is a result of 14-month-long painstaking negotiations and the process between the U.S. and Taliban facilitated by Pakistan. It was supposed to be signed in September last year, but President Trump called off the talks at the last minute due to the continuing Taliban attacks targeting American forces. Now, later, another stumbling block emerged after the Taliban sought more time to talk to other Afghan groups, even as the U.S. pushed for an intra-Afghan dialogue within 10 days of the peace deal. This prompted the U.S. ambassador, Zalmay Khalilzad, to make an unannounced visit to Islamabad on January 31st, seeking Pakistan's help to convince the Taliban for an intra-Afghan dialogue. Reports say Pakistan managed to break the stalemate and Taliban is expected to attend these talks on March 10th, which will be held either in Norway or Germany. So the question is, what is Islamabad getting out of this? Well, sources say the U.S. and Afghanistan have already begun addressing some of Pakistan's security concerns. Pakistan wants U.S. to eliminate anti-Pakistan elements operating on Afghan soil. In addition to this, Pakistan is also seeking the U.S. support to get off the FATF list. On the other hand, the Indian envoy in Doha will also be part of the Afghan peace deal. And the Indian Foreign Secretary Harsh Vardhan Shringla will be in Kabul. He will call on the Afghan President Ashraf Ghani as well. The U.S. President Donald Trump has also discussed the deal with Prime Minister Modi during his visit to India. Trump later said India would like the deal to happen. Meanwhile, the Afghan President Ashraf Ghani has postponed his inauguration on the U.S. American request. This after Washington raised concerns that the controversy over his re-election might hamper the signing of the peace deal with the Taliban later this week, which is now tomorrow. In a statement, the U.S. State Department asked Afghan authorities to address concerns over rigging. This after Ghani's rival Abdullah Abdullah contested the poll results and declared himself the winner. According to some reports in the Afghan media, Abdullah is even planning a rival inauguration. The confusion over the September 2019 election result has further weakened the position of the Afghan government, which is officially not part of the US-Taliban talks. This as Taliban rejected Kabul-based government as a puppet regime. However, both Washington and Taliban have said that they will hold separate talks with the Afghan government.
We're currently in a seven-day reduction in violence period that started on February 22nd. In 19 years of war, this is the first week-long break in violence by all sides, if we're successful in achieving it. If, and only if, it's successful, we will sign the U.S.-Taliban agreement coordinated with the Government of National Unity on or about February 29th that includes a timeline for both a conditions-based and phased troop withdrawal, and for the commencement of inter-Afghan negotiations.
Meanwhile, the week-long observance of the reduction of violence is underway in Afghanistan. Remember, the negotiations resumed after the Taliban agreed to reduce violence, while the U.S. said that it will not carry out operations against the terror group. Now, as per the peace deal, which will be signed in the Qatar capital of Doha, on Saturday, Taliban will give up arms in exchange of U.S. troop withdrawal from Afghanistan. The Taliban will also help Washington in its fight against the Al-Qaeda and the ISIS. The U.S. had also agreed to certain security arrangements proposed by Taliban as it seeks to end its longest war. And now, well, let's take a look at the timeline of events that led to the Afghanistan peace deal set to be signed tomorrow. And first, while in July 2018, the U.S. officials agreed to secretly meet the Taliban members in Qatar. Towards the end of the same year, Taliban announced meeting with U.S. officials to find a roadmap to peace. In February 2019, intra-Afghan talks took place between the Taliban and other Afghans in Moscow, which did not include the Afghan government. In the same month, peace talks began between the Taliban and the U.S. in Qatar. Now, 2 months later, the Afghan government hosted a four-day-long event called the Loya Jirga. That is a special legal assembly for peace efforts for which the Taliban was not present. In August 2019, the U.S. and Taliban completed 8 rounds of talks in Qatar. In the next month, that's September 2019, the U.S. announced the withdrawal of the 5,400 troops within 20 weeks as part of the deal. Now, following the announcement, the president, that is Donald Trump, cancelled the peace talks with Taliban. Later, the Taliban sent a delegation to Moscow to discuss prospects of the U.S. troop withdrawal. And then the Taliban reached out to the U.S. for talks, saying the U.S. has the most to lose. In September 2019, Zalmay Khalilzad was appointed as the U.S. president, Donald Trump's special representative to Afghanistan on October 12, 2019. Zalmay Khalilzad met the Taliban in Qatar for the first time. Next month, on November 12, 2019, Taliban representatives and the U.S. special envoy met for the second time. On December 3, 2019, Trump sent a letter to Pakistan asking for help with the Afghan peace process. The same month, on December 17, 2019, Taliban representatives met with the U.S. officials in Abu Dhabi, but on December 30, 2019, Taliban dismissed Afghanistan's peace talk offer, and on January 6, 2020, the Taliban demanded a shift in the venue for the talks. On January 14, 2020, the U.S. set forth 2 demands for the Taliban going further. On January 22, 2020, the U.S. and the Taliban resumed talks in Qatar. And on January 24th this year, the U.S.-Taliban talks were extended for 2 more days. And the Taliban appointed Mullah Baradar as the head of the Qatar office. And in February this year, Afghan National Security Council announced a week-long reduction in the violence beginning February 22nd. So that is a long timeline of events of how they've panned out over the last so many years. All right, joining us now to talk a little bit more about this is my colleague Siddhant Sibbal. And of course, the ramifications of this peace deal will be felt all over the subcontinent, particularly here for India. And Siddhant, how closely, of course, is India monitoring the situation? The fact that Harshvardhan Shringla will be at the Doha talks is also a huge step to recognizing that there is a change of leadership that will happen in the years to come.
Closely watching the developments in Doha, we know that India has been invited for witnessing the signing of the agreement between Taliban and the United States. And it's a huge geopolitical development after 19 years. Finally, that day has come when a little semblance of certain kind of peace can be seen when it comes to the role Taliban is playing. We also know that the Indian government is sending its representative, the Indian envoy to Qatar, will be representing New Delhi. And even as we speak, we know that the Indian Foreign Secretary is in Kabul. He has met number of high-profile people and most of the stakeholders. He has met the acting foreign minister, the chief of the NSA, and other people as well. He is going to call on the president of Afghanistan as well. But the fact that India has been invited for witnessing the ceremony, it is an acknowledgement that New Delhi is a major stakeholder when it comes to Afghanistan, the Afghan peace process. Since 2001, when the Americans invaded Afghanistan, India has emerged as a major backer of the government in Kabul when it comes to political talks, high-level visits or connectivity, or in fact, infrastructure development. New Delhi has played a leading role. India has developed a lot of projects, from community projects to major infrastructure projects, whether it's the Afghan parliament in Kabul or the major dam, the India-Afghanistan Friendship Dam, also known as the Salma Dam in the western province of Herat. But the fact that the Americans will soon leave is something that is a cause of anxiety here in New Delhi. We know that the Indian Prime Minister and the American president had discussed this on Tuesday during the visit of the president of United States. And during the conversation, the troops, the withdrawal of the troops was discussed, and both sides agreed that the gains made in last 19 years should not go wasted, the democratic gains in which India has played a major role.
Right, absolutely, Sazan. Thanks very much indeed for joining us with the latest there. We're also joined by Anas Malik now from Doha for the latest on those peace negotiations and that peace deal to be signed, in fact. And Anas, tell us more of what we can expect from this peace deal and the fact that we're hoping that the nitty-gritties have all been cleared out ahead of the big day.
Well, baby, clearly the tables have turned because I'm standing in that very hotel, the Sheraton Grand Hotel, where the signing ceremony is to take place. And wherever you go, you either find a foreign delegate, a dignitary, or the Taliban roaming around in this hotel, something that was not possible to even out of imagination some years ago. Now we're seeing guests of the Taliban being invited to this ceremony. We've seen the Australian professor who was kidnapped by the Taliban. He will also be witnessing this signing ceremony. About 1,500 personnel, including dignitaries, including foreign dignitaries, delegates, guests of the Afghan Taliban, the Qatari government, and the US government, and alongside that media from all over the world, press from all over the world will be attending that. Now, if you talk about the modalities of this agreement, what I've been picking up from the Taliban sources here who've been literally roaming around in the lobby of this very hotel, they say that the agreement has been agreed upon in principle with regards to reduction in violence, number one. Number two, that Taliban would be fighting with the Afghan government in its quest to eliminate IS or the Dawlat Islami or Daesh from the region. Number three, that the Afghan soil will not be allowed to be used by any foreign state or any non-state actor against any country that includes Al-Qaeda. The fact that Al-Qaeda would be eliminated or would be pushed out is also part of the agreement. That is what Taliban sources here who've been, or guests of the Taliban who are here in Doha, they've been telling me. Alongside that, we also expect that with the signing of this agreement, this is part of the agreement, that after the signing of this agreement, in 10 to 12 days, there would be intra-Afghan negotiations at a European country. So we're expecting that to happen somewhere between 10 to 15th of March, those intra-Afghan dialogue, and that would be very, very critical, given that who sits across, will it be the National Unity Government of Abdullah and Ashraf Ghani, or would it be the reps from Kabul, would be those who are on the basis of the recently held controversial presidential elections, where Ashraf Ghani was declared winner by the Independent Election Commissioner, and Abdullah had also claimed victory. So there's a lot of ambiguity over there on that bit as well. But if you talk about the arrangements, there are strict security arrangements that have been in place. I can just show you, these are the sort of cards that have been issued to media. You cannot, even for delegates as well, they would have to wear and visibly show their cards, their identity, only then they can enter this hotel, otherwise they cannot enter this hotel. There is stricter security. In fact, that very hall where the signing ceremony is to take place, that convention hall of the Sheraton Grand, it is currently cordoned off, it is out of bounds. It will open as early as 7 a.m. in the morning tomorrow, and it will be closed for all sort of entry of media at 10 a.m., though the actual event starts at around 2. So no risks are being taken. The U.S. side is yet to unveil who is coming, but in all likelihood, we're expecting Mike Pompeo to be signing the agreement on behalf of the U.S. with the Taliban. Yes, very
well. Right. Well, Anas, stay with us, and also back with us is Siddhant. And well, Siddhant, many feel that India came into the game too late, that it accepted the fact that the Taliban was a reality quite late. And in fact, this time around also, when the Foreign Secretary is going, he's also going to be meeting Ashraf Ghani. So clearly there has been some reluctance on India's part, and for all the valid reasons, to negotiate with the Taliban.
Well, there is a history of this reluctance. The history is primarily for two reasons. In the 90s, we know when Taliban was in Kabul, We know that the situation of minorities wasn't very good. Secondly, in 1999, the hijacking of IC-814 happened, something that officials here, the government here, whosoever comes, will never going to forget. The plane was hijacked from Kathmandu, taken to Kandahar, surrounded by Taliban at the behest of Pakistan, especially the notorious spy agency ISI. And we know what happened. That 1 week will be remembered. And of course, we know that since then, India has taken a number of measures. But by and large, these are the two reasons that why India is reluctant to talk to Taliban. Of course, the fact that India has accepted the invite of the Qatari government to send its envoy to be part and to be witness of this historic development, right, shows that India understands ground reality and understands that Taliban will come in some form or another in the government and in the society. So these are steps being taken. It will be worth watching what will the new policy of New Delhi when it comes to Taliban.
Absolutely. Siddhant and Anas, thanks very much indeed for joining us for the latest there. We will keep coming back to you for more on this big story as the day proceeds and, of course, tomorrow as well.